Well, good evening, everybody, and welcome to this webinar service of Dewsbury Evangelical Church. And you're very welcome, whether this is the first time you've joined us or whether you've been with us many occasions. My name is Daniel Grimwade, and I'm the pastor of the church. And we're looking forward this evening to hearing Colin Mountain speak. We've been thinking about faithfulness today in our series on the fruit of the Spirit. And he's going to be looking at the Old Testament and an example of faithfulness that we discover there. Just so you know what's happening, this first part of the service is going to last around 40 minutes or so. Then there'll be a short break. And then at around 6:45, we'll be jumping on our church family Zoom to have a chance to catch up with one another and pray together. And if you'd like to join us for that meeting and you don't know the link, it's a different Zoom link, then please email us on info@dewsbury-church.org.uk and we'll make sure you've got the link and can join us. So that's 6:45 through till 7:20 when we will finish. Well, we're going to begin by singing God's praise, and the song we're singing now is from the Breaking of the Dawn.
Setting of the sun, I will stand on every promise of your word. Words of power strong to say that will never pass away. I will stand on every promise of your word. For your promise of your word. When I stumble and I sin, condemnation pressing in, I will stand on every promise of your word. You are faithful to forgive, that in freedom I might live. So I stand on every promise of your word. Guilt awareness sets restored. You remember sin no more. So I stand on every promise of your word. Choice, I will listen for your voice, and I stand on every promise of your word. Through this dark and troubled land, you will guide me with your hand, as I stand on every promise of your word. You've promised to complete every work begun in me. So I stand on every promise of your word. Hey.
Well, let's come and pray to our God. Lord, we pray that what we have sung might be true of us, that we would be those that indeed stand on every promise of your word. Forgive us for the fact that often we are unbelieving or unsure. Our faith is small. Help us to see again what a good and faithful God you are, and that your grace is sufficient. Thank you that the Lord Jesus spoke to us and said, "My grace is sufficient for you, and my power is made perfect in weakness." Lord, may we know and build our lives on the reality of that truth. Help us as we go forth into this coming week to be those that, whatever the circumstances of our lives, are rock solid in our trust and dependence upon you, who is good and gracious and kind. Lord, we long that the fruit of faithfulness might be seen in our lives too. And we pray that you would help us then this evening as we consider this subject further. Pray you would help Colin now as he speaks to us about the life of Joseph and shows us his faithfulness being worked out in various ways in his life, which thank you that all of your word is useful to teach us and correct us and instruct us in righteousness. And so we pray that you would do that for us now. So hear our prayers as we come in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, over to you, Colin.
Well, good evening, everyone. We've been trying in these messages on the fruit of the Spirit to show that the context of the list in Galatians chapter 5 is that they're primarily relational. In other words, they've got to do with our relationships with each other. And the list of the fruit contrasts markedly with the list which precedes it, the acts of the flesh. And what Paul is doing is illustrating to the Galatians that if they're to be led by the Spirit, then this fruit will characterize all their relationships, all their living with each other. And I found this insight really helpful. I think it's given real context to the fruit. Now, as we heard this morning, faithfulness here means being utterly reliable, trustworthy, dependable, keeping your promises, doing what you say, and making sure that you do it in the time that you say. Now, of course, these qualities relate also to our relationship with God himself. We are to be true to him. We are to stick to him. We are to keep our promises to him. That's absolutely correct. But it's not what is meant here when Paul lists faithfulness as one of the fruit of the Spirit. And I want to try and illustrate this in the life of Joseph. Now, it's Mark that's been assigning these passages, these Old Testament passages, on Sunday evenings. And he gave me Genesis chapter 47, but I'm afraid I'm going to look at various other aspects in Joseph's life, which span the last 14 chapters of Genesis. And we'll read various bits of the story as we go along. I say we, Judith's going to read them for me so that it provides a bit of a change of voice rather than just mine all the time. Now, most of you will know the story well. We first meet Joseph in Genesis chapter 37.
Joseph, a young man of 17, was tending the flocks with his brothers, the sons of Bilhah and the sons of Zilpah, his father's wife, and he brought their father a bad report about them. Now Israel loved Joseph more than any of his other sons, because he'd been born to him in his old age, and he made an ornate robe for him. When his brothers saw that their father loved him more than any of them, they hated him and could not speak a kind word to him.
Joseph was a bit of a telltale, arrogant youth, not helped by the unwise favouritism lavished upon him by his father Jacob. You remember that he had dreams of bound sheaves of corn in the field, bowing down to Joseph's sheaf, and also the sun, moon and 11 stars bowing down to him. When he told his father the dreams, even he was angry, because it seemed that his dreams were saying that he and Joseph's mother and his 11 brothers would bow down before him. And his brothers especially hated him and were jealous. So his brothers hatched a plan to kill him, and they put him in a pit, but later relented and sold him to some camel traders and kept his coat of many colours, smeared it in animal blood, and told their father that wild animals must have eaten him. So Joseph is taken to Egypt.
Now Joseph had been taken down to Egypt. Potiphar, an Egyptian who was one of Pharaoh's officials, the captain of the guard, bought him from the Ishmaelites who had taken him there.
Now it's at this point that I want to look more carefully at Joseph's life and see how he illustrated this fruit of faithfulness. And there's two sort of main aspects that I want to bring out. The first one is that Joseph was utterly dependable and reliable and trustworthy in all that he did. And the three areas in Joseph's life particularly where we see this, we see it first of all in Potiphar's house, the chap who bought him.
The Lord was with Joseph so that he prospered, and he lived in the house of his Egyptian master. When his master saw that the Lord was with him and that the Lord gave him success in everything he did, Joseph found favour in his eyes and became his attendant. Potiphar put him in charge of his household, and he entrusted to his care everything he owned. From the time he put him in charge of his household and of all that he owned, the Lord blessed the household of the Egyptian because of Joseph. The blessing of the Lord was on everything Potiphar had, both in the house and in the field. So Potiphar left everything he had in Joseph's care. With Joseph in charge, he did not concern himself with anything except the food he ate.
Basically, it meant that Potiphar didn't have a care in the world except to decide what he wanted to eat. He entrusted everything he owned to Joseph. And remember that Potiphar had bought Joseph as a slave. He was a foreigner, he'd no rights. Joseph could have chosen to reject his past and the dreams he'd experienced, but he didn't. And in fact, knowing that God was with him, he chose to please God by being a reliable, trustworthy servant. But as we know, things didn't stay like that. And we're told in verse 7 that Joseph was well built and handsome, and that Potiphar's wife soon had eyes for him and tried to seduce him. She blatantly said, "Come to bed with me."
But he refused. "With me in charge," he told her, "my master does not concern himself with anything in the house. Everything he owns, he's entrusted to my care. No one is greater in this house than I am. My master has withheld nothing from me except you, because you are his wife. How then could I do such a wicked thing and sin against God?" And though she spoke to Joseph day after day, he refused to go to bed with her or even be with her.
Now, there's a lot that could be said here, which is helpful to us. But I just want to make the point that Joseph was, in this matter of sexual behaviour, also faithful to his master, Potiphar, and of course to God. He was trustworthy and reliable in not betraying the trust that Potiphar had in him, even regarding his wife. He was scrupulous in this. But of course, all this landed Joseph then in prison. And again, we see Joseph's faithfulness in prison, because Potiphar's wife had lied about him, that he wouldn't sleep with her. But how does Joseph behave in prison?
But while Joseph was there in prison, the Lord was with him. He showed him kindness and granted him favour in the eyes of the prison warden. So the warden put Joseph in charge of all those held in the prison, and he was made responsible for all that was done there. The warden paid no attention to anything under Joseph's care, because the Lord was with Joseph and gave him success in whatever he did.
Did you know that? The prison warden paid no attention to anything under Joseph's care. He was responsible for everything that was done there. Yes, it's true, of course, that the Lord showed him kindness and granted him favour. But that doesn't lessen Joseph's trustworthiness and reliability. But we'll come back to that point later on. The story of Joseph is so exciting, it's hard to reduce it, but I must do that. Most of you know that Joseph interprets dreams for two of the prisoners who were in the prison with him. And these dreams come true. And eventually, I think it's a couple of years later, Joseph is summoned to interpret a dream for Pharaoh himself. This is the dream concerning the 7 fat cows followed by the 7 thin cows, which ate up the fat cows. Joseph acknowledges that only God gives the interpretation of dreams and tells Pharaoh that there will be 7 fruitful years of harvest, but that they will be followed by 7 terrible years of famine. And so Joseph boldly advises Pharaoh to look for a discerning and a wise man to manage all Egypt's affairs so that the country will not be ruined by the famine. And so we see Joseph now in Pharaoh's service and his faithfulness there.
So Pharaoh said to Joseph, "I hereby put you in charge of the whole land of Egypt." Then Pharaoh took his signet ring from his finger and put it on Joseph's finger. He dressed him in robes of fine linen and put a gold chain around his neck. He had him ride in a chariot as his second in command, and people shouted before him, "Make way!" Thus he put him in charge of the whole land of Egypt.
And then we go on to read a little bit later.
Joseph was 30 years old when he entered the service of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. And Joseph went out from Pharaoh's presence and travelled throughout Egypt. During the 7 years of abundance, the land produced plentifully. Joseph collected all the food produced in those 7 years of abundance in Egypt and stored it in the cities. In each city, he put the food grown in the fields surrounding it. Joseph stored up huge quantities of grain, like the sand of the sea. It was so much that he stopped keeping records because it was beyond measure.
Now, we get a lot of details later on in chapter 47 of how Joseph manages these famine years. His experience in Potiphar's house and then in the prison were good preparation for the formidable task he now had to save not only Egypt, but in fact, the whole known world. And at the end of it all, despite the fact that the people were now in bondage to Pharaoh, they had had to sell themselves to him so that they could get seed to plant crops. The people said to Joseph, "You have saved our lives." From spoilt teenager to prime minister of Egypt, we find Joseph in many different situations. From his point of view, some good, some bad. But through it all, we find him to be someone who others trust, who find him dependable, someone who is reliable. How does that work out for us in our lives? Now, this morning, Daniel mentioned several areas. I just want to pick on 3. They overlap with what Daniel said this morning. But it means that at work, whether in the office, whether in the factory, whether working from home, we will be doing the best job that we can. It won't matter if the manager or the boss is there or not. We'll aim to be totally dependable and reliable. Are we using our time properly and not taking advantage by perhaps surfing the net and being on the phone when we should be working? And of course, this is also true for at school or college. I think it must have been particularly difficult when having to work at home. Can the teacher or the lecturer trust us to get on with the task? Of course, that's also true for the teacher and the lecturer. Do they get on with the work that they should be doing? Faithfulness in church life. Whatever our responsibilities, whether we're elders or deacons, whether we're Sunday school teachers, but in lots of other areas where we've got responsibilities, are we being dependable? Do others see us as those who are faithfully serving the Lord and the church, working hard, men and women of integrity and faith, which works itself out to the glory of God? Faithfulness in just being there week after week. The Apostle Paul uses the illustration of the church as a body, each part essential for the good of the whole. Are you and I reliable in whatever our task and responsibility is? And then in the home and in all our relationships with friends, faithfulness is going to show itself: reliable, trustworthy, loyal, dependable. I think it's a very down-to-earth quality, this, isn't it? A very down-to-earth fruit. You can easily see what it is. Love, joy, peace, that may be a bit more difficult to put your finger on sometimes, but not faithfulness. I'm not saying by that it's easy to live this out day by day, but I think it is clear what it is and what pleases God in our behaviour. So we see then in Joseph's life, he was utterly dependable and trustworthy. But there's also another aspect of Joseph's life, which is also exemplified in this fruit of faithfulness. And that is the fact that Joseph kept his promises. Now, that's close related to the fact that he's utterly independable. They're together in many ways. But let's just see how Joseph kept his promises. Now, we don't have time to look at the story of how Joseph came to meet his father and brothers in Egypt. The famine affected Canaan, of course. And so Joseph's father, Jacob, sent his other sons, that's Joseph's other brothers, to find food there. Now, when Joseph saw them, he was overwhelmed to see them. But they didn't recognize him, and he needed to know that they had changed and were repentant for the way that they had treated Joseph. And he wanted to be sure that they wouldn't behave in the same way again, out of jealousy or greed to one of his other brothers. So Joseph arranges three tests for them, which they pass, and so prove to Joseph that they were indeed changed men. And it's at that point that Joseph reveals himself to his brothers.
Then Joseph could no longer control himself before all his attendants, and he cried out, "Have everyone leave my presence." So there was no one with Joseph when he made himself known to his brothers, and he wept so loudly that the Egyptians heard him, and Pharaoh's household heard about it. Joseph said to his brothers, "I'm Joseph. Is my father still living?" But his brothers were not able to answer him because they were terrified at his presence. Then Joseph said to his brothers, "Come close to me." When they had done so, he said, "I'm your brother Joseph, the one you sold into Egypt. And now do not be distressed and do not be angry with yourselves for selling me here, because it was to save lives that God sent me ahead of you. For 2 years now there's been famine in the land, and for the next 5 years there will be no ploughing and reaping. But God sent me ahead of you to preserve for you a remnant on earth and to save your lives by a great deliverance."
Joseph pledges himself to his brothers. There's no malice. There's no desire to get revenge. He tells them how everything that has happened to him is God's plan to save the world from the famine, and indeed his own family. If Joseph had not gone to Egypt and then interpreted Pharaoh's dreams, then there wouldn't have been the provision that Joseph made. But we see specifically how Joseph keeps his promise to his father, Jacob. Jacob had come to Egypt. He meets Pharaoh, meets the whole family, and they're settled in the land of Goshen.
Jacob lived in Egypt 17 years, and the years of his life were 147. When the time drew near for Israel to die, he called for his son Joseph and said to him, "If I've found favour in your eyes, put your hand under my thigh and promise that you will show me kindness and faithfulness. Do not bury me in Egypt, but when I rest with my fathers, carry me out of Egypt and bury me where they are buried." "I'll do as you say," he said. "Swear to me," he said. Then Joseph swore to him, and Israel worshipped as he leaned on the top of his staff.
And then when Jacob died?
When the days of mourning had passed, Joseph said to Pharaoh's court, "If I have found favour in your eyes, speak to Pharaoh for me. Tell him, my father made me swear an oath and said, I'm about to die. Bury me in the tomb I dug for myself in the land of Canaan. Now let me go up and bury my father, then I will return." Pharaoh said, "Go up and bury your father as he made you swear to do." So Joseph went up to bury his father.
Now, this was all very important to Jacob. And in fact, it would also be true of Joseph himself. Joseph also wanted to be buried in Canaan, not primarily because of sentiment or superstition, as it's maybe the case today when people want to be buried in a certain place. But Canaan was the land of promise. This was part of God's covenant with Abraham. Canaan, not Egypt, was the land of promise. To be buried in the land showed Jacob's trust in the faithfulness of God to keep his word. Even though the family had now left Canaan, he believed that they would return one day. And that is also what Joseph believed.
Then Joseph said to his brothers, I'm about to die, but God will surely come to your aid and take you up out of this land to the land he promised on oath to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob.
And we read in Exodus 13 that Moses took the bones of Joseph with him when they left Egypt in the Exodus, took them back to the promised land. But the point here is that Joseph kept his promise to his father, Jacob. He did what he said he would do. But also Joseph kept his promise to his brothers. And sort of after the funeral, as it were, we read,
when Joseph's brothers saw that their father was dead, they said, what if Joseph holds a grudge against us and pays us back for all the wrongs we did to him? So they sent word to Joseph saying, your father left these instructions before he died. This is what you are to say to Joseph. I ask you to forgive your brothers the sins and the wrongs they committed in treating you so badly. Now please forgive the sins of the servants of the God of your father. When their message came to him, Joseph wept. His brothers then came and threw themselves down before him. We are your slaves, they said. But Joseph said to them, don't be afraid. Am I in the place of God? You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. So then, don't be afraid. I will provide for you and your children. And he reassured them and spoke kindly to them.
Joseph had already told his brothers that he'd forgiven them and that God's plan was being fulfilled. But here he has to reassure them. His promise to them was true. What he'd said before is what he meant. They had no need to be afraid. He wasn't going to say one thing to them when his father was alive and now something different when he was dead. He was a man of his word. That's this fruit of faithfulness. See, faithfulness is being reliable and dependable, but it also means being utterly true to your word, doing what you say you will do and doing it when you say you will do it. It means keeping your promises. Promises in marriage. Now, both Mark, when he was dealing with the children this morning, dealing with the seventh commandment, and then Daniel, in some of the things he said, dealt with this as well. Promises in marriage. It means being like Joseph was regarding Potiphar's wife, steadfastly refusing to contemplate any other relationship except with the one that you have made promises to before God. The world thinks less and less of adultery and sex before marriage, and living together in casual sex are the norm, but not for a Christian. And those of us who are married must have eyes only for our spouse. That's the promise that we have made. And when we become church members, then we are making promises to each other, to pray for one another, to support one another. We need to be careful when we say that we will pray for someone. If we say that we're going to pray for them, then we need to pray for them. We also promise to support the ministry financially. It's easy to pledge money and not to fulfill it, but faithfulness demands it. And in everyday life, we are to be those who are known to keep our word. The world will judge us on this. You say you will do something for someone in the church or for a neighbour or someone at work, and then you don't do it, or have to be reminded again and again, perhaps never doing it. Do you have a reputation for this? It's not honouring to God. Casualness is not a mark of being spiritual, rather the opposite. But the fruit of the Spirit means being faithful, reliable, trustworthy, known for keeping your promises, for doing what you said you will do, and when you said you would do it. Well, let's bring all this together. Two further points that I want to make in conclusion. First of all, we always think of the story of Joseph as illustrating how God overrules in human affairs to achieve his purposes. I've already quoted verse 20 to you. You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. And this is true, of course. It's a wonderful example of how God overrules even our sinful actions to achieve his purpose. The murderous jealousy of the brothers is overruled, But what is also true is that God uses our faithfulness to achieve his purposes. And we see that in Joseph's life. All the way through, we read how God was with Joseph in Potiphar's house. We read, the Lord was with him and he prospered. The Lord gave him success in everything he did. In prison, we read, the Lord was with him and gave him success. In Pharaoh's court, Pharaoh recognized that the Spirit of God was in Joseph and that he was the man to save them in the famine. Does that mean then that Joseph would have been faithful whatever? That's the way it was going to be, because God was with him, giving him this success? No, it doesn't. We are responsible for our actions. And in the same way that God overrules our sinfulness to achieve his purpose, so he uses, in this case, Joseph's faithfulness to achieve his purpose. Joseph was a wonderful example of living a life of faithfulness to God, but also faithfulness to those he worked for, which ultimately was for all God's people. He was a shining example of this fruit of faithfulness. He showed it to a remarkable degree, and because of that, God blessed him and used him to achieve his purpose. But all the glory goes to God, because he was with his servant and gave him success in everything he did. Now, of course, we have here an example again of the sovereignty of God and the responsibility of man, of human beings. I can't fathom it, of course, but that's the way it is. You and I are to strive to be faithful and live out this fruit which comes from God by his Spirit. It is a fruit of the Spirit. But it is only as we depend on him and his grace that we will have any success. Our faithfulness does not earn our salvation, of course, never. But our faithfulness does show that God's grace is in us. In Titus chapter 2 and verse 10, Paul instructs Titus to teach slaves not to steal from their masters. He says this, but to show that they can be fully trusted, so that in every way they will make the teaching about God our Saviour attractive. See, living like this can create great gospel opportunities, both because it is attractive, but also because it can bring persecution, especially in countries, and maybe increasingly in this country, where corruption in everyday life is rampant. And the Christian who lives faithfully stands out as a bright light for Christ. And the second and final thing I want to say in conclusion is, we know that we fail. We're not totally dependable and reliable at all times. We know there have been times, perhaps many times, when we failed to keep our promises. The life of Joseph and his faithfulness to God and his faithfulness to people points us to the Lord Jesus Christ. Joseph was the saviour of his people on one level, but only Jesus was totally faithful to God in all his life, in all his relationships with people, and whose death at the hands of sinful and responsible men God overruled to accomplish salvation for all those who come to Jesus in their sin and weakness. Jesus' blood provides a covering for all our failures, and we can find grace and help from him to the people he wants us to be in showing this fruit of faithfulness. Amen.
Thank you, Colin, so much. We're really helpful example and illustration and of faithfulness in action there in the life of Joseph. Really helps us to get a handle on this subject. Okay, we're going to sing as we close this part of the service. And the song is What a Faithful God Have I. And we're joining with the congregation at the Aberystwyth Conference as we sing this song together. Well, thank you so much for joining us, and we've come to the end of the service and time together. We'll be back meeting in person next Sunday morning at 10:30 in our building. You can also join online to watch that, or again next Sunday evening at 6 o'clock. So please do join us there. Let me just pray as we close our time this evening. We thank you, our God, that we have a faithful God. What a faithful God have I. And Lord, we pray, whether at home or at work or at church, that we might be those faithful people that you have called us to be. And Lord, when we reflect on our lives, we recognize that we've not always been faithful. We have let people down. We have broken our promises. We've not been utterly reliable and dependable. And so we ask you to forgive us, and we thank you that there is cleansing for us and forgiveness for us in the Lord Jesus Christ, that he is the perfect saviour. But Lord, we long to be more and more like him. So thank you for what we've heard this evening, and hear our prayers now. Go before us, we ask, in Jesus' name. Amen. So join us, do join us in a few minutes then over on the Church Family Zoom about 7:15 for chat and prayer together. Thanks for being with us. Good evening.